The year was 2015, and we as humans were, oh, so naive. Things were different back then. You could go watch a movie in a theater or eat food in a restaurant. You could even shoot 4K on a DSLR that could see in the dark. Well, almost. The Sony A7S revolutionized a lot of things. Sony was already a heavy hitter in television and film, and their stills camera line was well respected and had some great video features as well. And then the A7S came out, and Sony shot to the lead in that market as well. Along with the A7R II, A6000, and their descendants, Sony was a little bit like Canon was 7 years before, as far as it comes to revolutionizing how we thought about DSLR and mirrorless cameras. Except they actually seemed to know what they were doing. The A7S really piqued my interest. Not only was it full frame and had amazing low light capabilities, but it came with a nearly cinema quality log and gamut built in. And it could record 4K. Almost. Back then, you had to use an external recorder to do that. Having acquired my first personal 4K camera, I needed to put it through its paces. So I teamed up with my friend and amazing photographer Austin Lindsay, and we put a little spec ad together.
Mountain Dew. A sophisticated soft drink. For a sophisticated soft drinker.
Stylized, definitely imperfect, but still fun, hopefully. So here's how we did it. Like I mentioned earlier, we were shooting on the A7S and we were recording to an Atomos Shogun. The lens we were using was the Nikon 28-70 2.8, and we probably had that around a 40mm or so. And for movement, we were just using my cheap eBay slider. So, as usual, we start by lighting the scene as a whole, and then we'll finesse the talent and product into the shot afterwards. And here it was pretty simple. We used some puck lights that you can just get from your local hardware store, put some amber-colored gel on them, and place them at the bottom of this corrugated steel background. Next, we hung some amber-tinted Edison bulbs over the bar, and then we were set. Now, to finesse our talent, we, of course, used a few more lights. We started with an RE650 with a Chimera and grid above and in front of our talent. You can actually see its reflection in the bottle here. Of course, if I were to do this again, I would definitely flag off the reflection from the glass and bottle. We used a 150-watt light behind her on camera right, with a snoot targeted on the product. This allowed our bottle to glow the way that it does here. We should have had a special light for our citrus to give it a nice rim, but live and learn. We also had two 650s, probably with two double scrims in each, 3/4 behind her on each side. I wish we had put them through some diffusion, because I truly dislike this shadow the hair casts right here. But they do give really nice shape to her arm, and a nice shine to her hair. Alright, now check out this shot here. Doesn't the lens and lighting give a really neat painterly aesthetic to her? This is probably my favorite thing from this whole spec. This shoot was actually a pretty good lesson for me on controlling shape on reflective surfaces. We spent some time on it for the close-up here, but on these other shots, you can see that on the bottle and glass, there are dots and lines all over the place. I would like to think on a bigger shoot, we'd have spent more time working on that. Now, this experience paid off later when I shot some promo stuff for Blendtec, which turned out nicer, I think.
The key to working with reflective objects, at least for me, is to visualize creating shapes with white and black. The white being diffusion or bounce boards or little show cards that you can bring up close to an object, and the black coming from duvetine or just the negative space in a dark room. The key being, you want the black to stop any other reflections from showing up on your surface. And then you play with where you put those bounces and diffusions to try and accentuate the shapes and curves of the surface that you're photographing. The last thing you want to do is just completely wash it out with whatever light you're using. Something else that I learned on this shoot was the need to create a list of everything you want to accomplish in a shot before you actually start rolling. Now, I think we still made a pretty neat little spec ad here, but there was one thing that we had planned on doing that we completely forgot. Can you guess what it is? We didn't spray down the bottle. We actually went to the store, we got glycerin, we mixed it with water, we put it in a spray bottle, and then as we were starting to do tests with our lighting, we just completely forgot about it. Whoops. All right, now it's time for vocabulary.
Boo!
First, what is a chimera and a grid? A chimera is just a type of softbox that you put on a light. The light bounces around inside of it, and then it comes out some diffusion on the other end. It creates a really nice, soft look, and because the chimera or softbox connects directly to the light, it makes it a lot easier to move it around set. I also mentioned scrims, and they usually come in the kit you buy your light with. Sometimes these are referred to as scrims, even though I call them nets, but they do the same thing. They stop down how much light is hitting your subject. So why would you use a scrim instead of a dimmer? Well, specifically on tungsten lamps, when you start to dim them down, the color temperature starts to warm. So if you want to keep your color temperature the same, but reduce how much light is hitting something, use a scrim. Let me know if you have any thoughts or questions in the comments below. Or if you have any suggestions for the next video, let me know. Thanks again, and I'll see you next week.